Hi, I'm Mitch Gallagher. I'm coming to you from Mix LA in Tarzana, California. We're Chris Lord-Alge. Thanks for having us in your studio, man.
Hey, Mitch. Always a pleasure to have you here. Thanks for coming.
It is our pleasure to be here. Thanks for hosting us. And I thought that since we were here today, surrounded by all your incredible tools and toys, as it were, let's talk a little bit about your workflow, because you've had a few hits that you've mixed, and there's a process you go through when you start a mix and as you work your way through it. Tell us a little bit about how that works.
Well, I think my workflow is something that's left over from an era that's now forgotten, okay? I think the workflow that the modern mixer is into and the new engineers are missing out on the workflow I have. I have an instrument in front of me that gives me the workflow. It gives me the ability to use 10 fingers, not one, okay? Yeah, I have this here to play with plugins, but what makes the workflow work is a few simple things. The solid state console, solid state logic console, created a console with repeatability, okay? So I'm able to take a snapshot, and everything on this console is photographed and stored in here that looks like an 8-bit video game. But I can take a picture, I can get back to any mix I've done in the last 25 years. I can go back to the first mix on this console and it'll line up perfectly, the exact settings, okay? So that takes that out of the equation. Our job is to be able to repeat what we do to go back to it. Why? Because the artist changes their mind. Okay, because just because we think the mix is perfect doesn't mean it's gonna stay like that forever. So if we have to make changes, come back a week later, a month later, whatever, we can get back to it exact. Mm-hmm. So I build my life, build the way I work about getting back to it and getting back to it in 15 minutes. Wow. To me, that's the number, okay? You look around the room and say, man, nothing in here took 15 minutes. But the way it's set up is all my colors behind me, all my tools behind me are set on their setting, okay? The set in a sweet spot, okay? Any delays or reverbs I use, those are the only things that we have to change or adjust. I have so many that rather than change them, I just use a different one, okay? So with a workflow, if you constrict yourself to making this be the ultimate summing device, which that's words people understand, I have 44 channels. I have 44 faders of summing. Okay, so I build my sessions, which I have to look at a big screen because, you know, I am older than time, so I need big screen to look at.
Right.
And thanks for Howard Benson. He made me put a big screen in front of me because people weren't seeing it. They were seeing Grammys up there, and that was intimidating them. But my point is you're looking at the song,
right?
But you're using this tool to create it. So you make your workflow, which is vertical, match it horizontally. So top to bottom here goes left to right.
Okay.
I always park the same things in the same spots. Doesn't make every song sound the same. But what it means is when I go to reach, I can be like Stevie Wonder and it doesn't matter. I know that this is this and that's going to be that. Mm-hmm. So you take those things out of the equation and that's the workflow. So you actually build your session vertically to work horizontally. So the vocal is always in 17. So of course, my favorite limiter is always in 17.
Right.
Okay, my guitars are always in 25 through 32. So those things that are plugged into those areas are plugged in there for specific reasons. Things get parked in certain places because a compressor or that's just where you're going to go to.
Mm-hmm.
Like I never have the bass. The bass is always at these two faders, okay? The background vocals are always in front of me. The piano is always here. So as a guitar player, okay, you know that when you go to play, the chords are always in the same positions.
Right.
When you're mixing and creating music, why would you want to change that?
Mm-hmm.
So then you can use this as a creative device. Now, look, kids now, people now, they don't have this tool, but they need to not forget that this was our technology and we were able to use this giant workstation, mm-hmm. okay, in conjunction with audio tape or whatever we were using, digital or analog, to get the process right, to get the mixing part done, to get the engineering, the producing done. But with SSL, which is made the most, it's the most intelligent console made for one purpose and one purpose only, to make records and make music. And every single song you hear on the radio, most of them had mixed through an SSL. Your whole life of listening to music go way back, the biggest hits came off of this. Why? Because this is the machine that did it. But to be able to just literally name setup, take a snapshot, boom, play it back a year later, 10 years later, 5 minutes later, and know that it's there, gives you the ability to not worry.
Right.
You can turn your knobs so your freaking brain goes sideways. You can automate, do whatever you want. And with all the VCA automation, it's super simple. So it's a super simple, it's like a Mustang fastback. It's
right.
got a steering wheel, a gas pedal, a shifter.
Mm-hmm.
I don't even need the mirrors. Just punch it. And that's it. You don't need all this extra stuff. And with the automation, it does a few simple commands and that's it. So it's really up to someone who can play the instrument, right? And I think this is something so lost in technology. Okay, look, we're in a world where Pro Tools and the other DAWs are all kind of scratching to make it all work. And I get it, it works and it's cheap and inexpensive. But it's not really made our playing of the musical instrument any better. This is an instrument transferring audio through your ears, through your brain, through your feelings, and having it come out as a mix that makes the artist happy. That's our job. So we need tools that can do that. Sometimes I find the technology with Pro Tools and all the options take you beyond the simplicity and make it complicated. Mm-hmm. I just want to hit a button, automate. I feel this. I want to do this. I want to make it feel like this. I want to play. I want to play music. Okay, I don't want to build the amps. I don't want to build the guitar. I just want to pick it up and go. So what's going to make that happen? So that's what makes my workflow work. And right. I know it's pretty long-winded, but I'm trying to have this passion towards you showing that let's not get past the fact that this is an instrument not unlike the guitar you play, mm-hmm. not unlike the drums, or not unlike the singer's vocals, you know? Right. It's an instrument. And if we look at that as our part in this business is a musician, not a technician, then we're making music that has passion.
Right, right. So if I can just summarize, mm-hmm. two elements here. First of all, using the console for what the console is great at, but you're using the outboard almost as preset devices. So you have all of this gear, but you don't change those settings. When you pull up your lead vocal on channel 17, it's always the same limiter and you know what setting is going to be there. It's just part of your workflow, part of your signal path. So you've eliminated all the option anxiety of what compressor should I choose? How should I set it?
Option anxiety. I like that. I think the whole world has option anxiety. I think when you're pulling that window down and looking for a plug-in, it's option anxiety. Mm-hmm. I go nuts. It's like, can you get rid of the ones I'm never going to use?
Right.
Right. It's simple because look at it. The devices that I use have one sweet spot. They're level dependent, right? So if you have 400 compressors, if you have compressors, it's all level dependent. So if you think it's compressing too much, then less level from Pro Tools to your console. If you're not getting enough spank, as we call it, so hit it harder. So it's all about how much level you get it. People don't understand that that's how these things work. It's all level dependent.
Right.
You could have every plugin, like all my outboards, set exactly the same way, and I do, they're all presets. And then it's all level dependent. If I want to compress more, clip gain it up higher. So I'm sure people do that, but I think that's answers your question.
Right, right. And if I can move some of that into the world, the virtual world that many people live in, if I can speak for you, one recommendation would be to look at having a summing device, have some kind of physical control surface, some kind of a mixer that you can use with your interfaces. Yeah. Would be one thing.
Look, we can't all have a big surface audio console in front of us. There's a lot of options out there right now. I'm not going to sit here and try to tell you which ones they are because we're not here to do that, right? But there's a lot more options than there were a few years ago. Mm-hmm. So I think, look, if this is the instrument you want to play in your lifetime, look at what you're playing and invest in that.
Right.
Have a work surface. Whether you start with 8 faders, 16, 24, whatever, one is not enough, okay? One is not enough. Mm-hmm. I can't do that. I can't function in that because that's too limiting, okay? I have this, the more the merrier. Mm-hmm. Because as soon as I have one, I'm thinking about what are the other guys doing? And I want to touch them, and I have to do it all one at a time.
Right.
So my recommendation is to move forward into expanding how much of the audio you can manipulate in front of you at once.
Right. The other takeaway that I'll take back to my studio is maybe it's a good idea to set up a template inside your DAW where you have particular plugins that you're using for particular things and always set your arrangement up the same way you do on your console so you know when your vocal comes up, it's going through maybe a particular plugin that's always set in a particular way. And again, eliminate all of that option anxiety and get to work just with your ears.
A lot of it's building anxiety too because it'd be nice if you could just, and I'm sure you can, to make your template, to have your shortcut, you know, have your shortcut plugins. Look, I really don't think that the designer of this program, and I'm just going to be honest, I don't think the designer of Pro Tools really works the people that are creating. I think they have their own plans. They may listen to a few options, but you know what? Let us be involved. Let us help make the tools that we use be the tools that we want. But yeah, I think option anxiety is a great word. I think people buy thousands of plugins and think, wow, I'm going to be great. Well, no, I use like 5 plugins because, you know, it goes so far beyond what I want, you know. And sure, I experiment with different ones here and there when I'm searching. Mm-hmm. But then I get anxiety like really quick and I get bored because I've lost what's important is the song. look, there's so much great stuff out there. It's up to what you like in your toolbox. Everyone's got personal taste. I learned from a lot of the kids that are just starting what they pick, and I've learned what to use because of that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think if you build your world on repeatability and simplicity, you can focus on being creative and paint the picture. Then worrying about, I got to make the frame, I got to get the right paper. You know, you're worrying so much about what you create on that you're not creating. So take the tools, take the paint, do all that, but you're so worried about where it's ending up, you're not worrying about what you're actually creating.
Right, right. There you go. Workflow to support creativity.
Exactly.
I love it. Awesome.
Pleasure.
Thanks, man.
You got it, man.
Great to see you.
Same here.
Hopefully we'll see you soon.
We will.
All right. And thank you for joining me here at Mix LA in Tarzana, California with Chris Lord-Alge, getting you some great mixing tips there. And I'm Mitch Gallagher from Sweetwater.